Right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for our Neuroscience Grand Rounds. It is a real honor and privilege to welcome Amit Kochhar to be our speaker today. I'm going to keep it brief because I've been talking about his accomplishments for a long time here, but Dr. Kochhar is a double board certified surgeon in otolaryngology and facial plastic reconstructive surgery, and he's the director of facial nerve disorders at PNI. He's really one of the few people, not just in Southern California, but really in the country and the world, who performs complex microvascular head and neck reconstructions after trauma conditions and cancers to help our patients with facial injury and facial nerve issues, and is a real unbelievable resource for our patients as a result. He completed a otolaryngology head neck surgery residency at Johns Hopkins, and completed a fellowship in facial plastic reconstructive surgery at UCLA. He joined us after a career as a faculty member at Keck USC. He's active in publishing and in advancing the science of facial reanimation with over 36 publications. And today he is going to talk to us about innovations in the assessment, education, and management of patients with facial paralysis. Thank you again so much for joining us, Dr. Kochhar.
Thank you, Dr. Guan. I really appreciate you guys having me here again. I was here about 2 years ago when I first started at PNI, and I'm going to go through today some of the work that we've been doing to help assess these patients and things that we as clinicians can do better. Some of the things we found by talking to these patients and listening to what they have to say. So let's go to the next slide. There we go. So I have no financial disclosures. So I have a bunch of objectives. I'll try to break them down by sections. But first, I'd like to review the social and functional implications of facial paralysis and the dynamic procedures we can use for facial reanimation. I'm going to review some novel work that we're doing with Dr. Sivakumar as well on better understanding the acoustic neuroma patient experience after they develop facial paralysis, and provide data to support how well people like myself, facial plastic surgeons, are assessing these patients. And lastly, I'll be reviewing how artificial intelligence and machine learning can improve objective assessments of facial asymmetry. And I'll try to introduce a novel program for the automatic analysis of facial asymmetry for both static and kinetic movement. So I touched upon this the last time I was here, and I just will briefly review it again. So why is the face important? Well, from an evolutionary perspective, Charles Darwin wrote about the expression and emotions of man and animals. The face defines our individual identity. It also provides verbal and nonverbal communication cues. Emotional expression is universal and highly conserved among species, such that the ability to not only respond to someone or another animal's expressions is important. It's also important for that other animal to be able to understand and be able to convey what message you're trying to send them. And that is ultimately what will help you survive. When patients develop facial paralysis from any cause in the acute phase, or if they have chronic facial paralysis, it really affects all aspects of the face. In the upper face, it can lead to brow ptosis, visual field deficit just from having hooding of the eye. You have ineffective blink, which can lead to dry eye, irritation, epiphora, exposure keratitis, and eventual blindness if not corrected. In the mid face, complete collapse can cause, or the nasal valve can cause nasal obstruction. And in the lower face, there's oral incompetence associated with eking, difficulty with speech, articulation, and obviously the ability to display emotion. So how do we as observers perceive the face? Well, in this picture of my daughter, you can see here that there is a central triangle in which all of our eyes are brought to immediately. And data has suggested that within several milliseconds, the observer is drawn to the eyes, the nose, and the mouth of any animal or human that they're looking at. Now, what happens when we look at patients with facial paralysis? Well, this is a study done by some of my mentors at Johns Hopkins, Dr. Lisa and Masaru Ishii, a husband and wife team, and they've really studied how observers assess patients with facial deformities, specifically facial paralysis. They found that observers viewed patients with deformity as more disfigured and bothersome, And they also noticed that the location was more important than the size, such that a small central lesion was perceived to be worse than a large peripheral lesion on a cheek, forehead, or chin. And so what you see here from these heat maps are the location of where the retina focused its attention within a few milliseconds after seeing an image. And on the left side, normal repose and normal smile, you see that that central triangle is well-defined between the eyes and the mouth. However, when you look at somebody with facial paralysis, you see that the triangle is skewed. The psychological effects of facial paralysis are well known. We know that the psychological distress contributes more to social disability than the functional impairments do. Facial paralysis can lead to social isolation with depression in 65% of patients, which is 3 to 5 times the general population. Quality of life is also dramatically affected. We know that using utility outcome scores, facial paralysis actually ranked below monocular blindness and was on par with end-stage renal disease and HIV. This study was done in the 2000s when HIV was still considered a terminal illness. And obviously end-stage renal disease or needing to be on dialysis is also considered a near terminal illness as well in many cases. So patients were really ranking themselves in a very, very, very high risk group. Participants were willing to sacrifice 8 years of life with their paralysis for a normal face, and they would undergo a procedure with a 21% chance of death or 1 in 5 chance of death. And just as, you know, from a surgical standpoint, I don't think I would offer surgery to somebody who had a 21% chance of death, but these patients are willing to take that risk. And a large percentage of patients who are deemed cured by their physicians, including myself, still report subjective problems with facial movement and quality of life. So there's much more that we can do as providers. And so looking at our, you know, trying to decide how to spend my time and what research to focus on, you know, we, at the time when I started this project, I didn't really think I could, you know, generate new ideas on terms of how to actually perform surgery or how to change some of the things that we're doing, because I felt like we had good options. But what I wanted to really focus on was really assessing patients themselves and trying to hear from them what issues they were still having, even though we, as 20 to 30% of them, thought they were cured. And so we know what facial paralysis looks like, but what does it sound like? So this is an actual patient, a 43-year-old woman with an acoustic neuroma who developed postoperative facial paralysis. And this is in her own words. "And so I used to look in the mirror and I would walk away depressed because I did not know the person I was looking at. I had looked at myself in the mirror for 40 years and I was okay with my imperfections. But as soon as I had facial paralysis, I couldn't look at myself in the mirror anymore." So let's give a brief background on acoustic neuromas, or vestibular schwannomas as they're more commonly known. They're typically slow-growing tumors with an incidence of 1 per 100,000 persons per year. Management options, and this is more in the realm of Dr. Guan and Dr. Sivakumar and some of the, many of the neurologists and neurosurgeons, but it can be observation, it could be microsurgical resection or radiation or all of the above. Injury to the nerve or facial nerve can result in facial paralysis with significant functional, social, and psychological sequela. And the estimated incidence is 15 to 25% of patients will develop some type of facial weakness after surgery. Anxiety, depression, and anger are commonly noted in patients with facial paralysis. However, little is documented about how well acoustic neuroma patients in particular are educated about the development of facial paralysis after surgery or about the coordination of care following their facial paralysis. And so in order to do this project, we did qualitative research, focus groups, interviews, surveys, and I'll briefly go into what that is for some of the audience who may not be aware. These are research approaches that are used to understand complex everyday human experience in its natural settings. It's not the same as doing bench work. It's very different, be honest, and it's not something that I had a lot of experience with as a medical student or resident, where I spent my time doing basic science. Qualitative research conforms to the notions that reality is socially constructed and that inquiry is unavoidably value-laden. Reality is relative and multiple and perceived through socially constructed and subjective interpretations. And now, why is it important? Well, this research addresses the how and why questions, allowing us as the researcher to enable deeper understanding of experiences, phenomena, and context. And so in the setting of facial paralysis patients, you know, why is it that 20 to 30% of them are still having issues when we as providers are deeming them as cured? What are we missing in that part of the equation? And so trying to dig deeper into that. It allows us to ask questions that cannot really be put into numbers to understand the everyday human experience. And it allows you to see the everyday realities of social phenomena and studies and study important questions that are really practiced to help answer the bigger ones. And so our objectives in this study were to learn about the AN patient's educational experience related to paralysis as a sequela of their treatment, and to focus on how the facial paralysis itself impacted their physical, emotional health, self-perception, and social interactions. So as I mentioned, we did qualitative semi-structured interviews. We also looked at quality of life metrics, depression scale, the PHQ-9, and anxiety indices. And so these are just a list of the questions we did in the interview with these patients. We asked about their employment status. We asked about when their paralysis began, what treatments they'd had, what groups they interact with. We talked about symptoms. We asked them about daily activities, what they had and had not done anymore since the paralysis set in. We asked about changes they'd experienced, how well they had communicated that to their physicians, and asked them if their physician had offered help for aspects of this disease that wasn't necessarily related to their initial tumor that they had seen them for. We asked patients about self-perception, how the paralysis made them feel about themselves, if they had had changes over time, if they noticed a change in mood or emotions, and also, again, did the physicians offer help for these emotional aspects of the disease? And then we asked several questions about treatment, what treatments were offered, how well were they educated on these treatments, and what they expected their physician to ask them, or what thoughts they had about being a part of the being a part of the process. So from performing the interviews with patients, four major themes were identified in these interviews. And these themes were identified by reviewing each of the interviews, coding them using software, and then seeing what themes were common. And so four common themes were found were a lack of sufficient patient education about facial paralysis, not about their tumors per se, but about actually the sequela that they experienced, a lack of appropriate care coordination related to the diagnosis of facial paralysis. They also commented on significant changes in physical and emotional health and significant changes in their social interactions with others. And this is just a representative quote from a patient describing the lack of education that they experienced. Oops, sorry. On one hand, I was told you have to be patient. I said, okay. So I went home and I was patient. It was 6 months later. It was 9 months later. I didn't understand. What does that mean? Be patient. How long do I need to be patient for before I start to see, start needing to do something? There wasn't much communication. There was no discussion about the side effect of synkinesis. Lack of care coordination, representative quote, can I just say coordination was almost non-existent. There was no resources, no other support, nothing else. That's an area for me that really needs improvement. Never was I ever referred any place or said there's an Acoustic Neuroma Association or Facial Paralysis Facebook page, nothing. I had to find all of that on my own. When we talk about the changes in physical and emotional health, the more common ones in physical health were noted, ocular issues, eating issues, or speech and synkinesis. But when it came to talking about emotional changes such as depression, one patient said that they had no hope. Another patient said that gave the quote that I mentioned earlier about not being able to look in the mirror anymore. They even mentioned how reduced their confidence was and feeling self-conscious. A patient specifically said, I'm definitely less confident. I'm very guarded. I made myself very reserved. Who I allow in my life right now. I avoid social situations. One of my favorite things to do is to go out to eat, and now that's difficult. Lastly, the fourth theme, changes in social interactions. Patients found that friends and family were actually, those bonds became stronger. However, when it came to meeting with strangers or in the workplace, they had a very difficult time interacting with people that, one, they didn't know, or people that were coworkers saying that it's affected their income and affected their work tremendously. In the virtual world, patients did mention that they did find Facebook groups, facial paralysis groups, where they did find support, and they did find stories they could share about doctors and excited about different treatments they were getting. Now, looking at the flip side, not so much at the patient, but looking at facial plastic surgeons like myself, we wanted to also try to understand what the treating physician was looking at when they were seeing patients with facial paralysis and how well we were really assessing patients, not just from a physical standpoint, but also from an emotional standpoint. And so in this project, we wanted to investigate what aspects of management were most important to the reconstructive surgeon and to assess if these surgeons were managing both physical and mental health equally. And so we performed interviews with 10 facial plastic surgeons. We then transcribed and performed thematic analysis using the same program we used for the patients. Again, these are some of the questions we asked during the interviews. What type of practice were they in when they started treating patients with facial paralysis or when they started learning about it? And which types of facial paralysis patients they treated most often. We asked them about their clinical experience, about how often they were seeing patients. We asked them about their approach, what techniques they used, what if anything had changed the way or made things more challenging for caring for patients. We asked them about the most and least difficult treatments or least difficult aspects of treatment and whether they had changed their treatment protocols. We asked them which parts of the history and physical exam are most important. Did that change during the course of treatment for these doctors? Do they use photos or videos as a way to measure progress? And then did they also use questionnaires or quality of life metrics? And lastly, we went into the treatments that they offered, which ones they felt most confident using, which area was most important to treat, and what they would like to change about the way they treat patients and if they're satisfied with the care they're providing. And then finally, we went into, did they feel that the patient was involved in the treatment process and if they provided any educational materials for patients, knowing that patients had already said that they felt like they were missing out on educational materials from their original doctors who treated the acoustic neuroma. So from the 10 doctors interviewed, we found that 6 doctors did provide educational materials, 5 specifically asked about mental health, and 6 said they offered referrals to mental health if needed, and 7 noted that mental health was a priority more now in their current practice back as of 2021, 2022 than when they had started practicing years earlier. And the themes that we identified from these interviews were that surgeons were interested in the lifestyle changes related to facial paralysis. They believed they did have a grasp on the emotional experience, that they were satisfied with the therapeutic options currently available. However, they were not satisfied with the tools that they could use to measure outcomes. A representative quote to show the patient's interest suggests that one doctor stated, "I'll ask them, what is the most troublesome part of this whole situation? What bothers you the most?" And then they ask them how facial paralysis affects them, affects their daily life, and what they can do to help with their lifestyle. In terms of understanding the emotional experience, one doctor states, describing patients of theirs, that these facial paralysis patients feel very self-conscious. They're aware of others looking at them. They are hyper-aware of their asymmetry. It can create some anxiety about social situations that leads to a little bit of more social withdrawal, so they're less likely to go out and do things, particularly things like eating, especially in a vulnerable time for them, if they have trouble with oral competence and whatnot. So facial paralysis creates social isolation and feelings of depression. And if you look at this, it almost mirrors the quote that was given by the patient. So it does seem that the physician here is really understanding and empathetic to these patients' issues. That slide is not, oh, there we go. Satisfaction with therapeutic options. While there's still areas we have room to grow and improve, I'm not saying all options we fully address all their needs, but with our current medical knowledge, we are giving good treatment options for patients. And then with the one area where doctors or surgeons were looking for more help was in measuring outcomes. And so one representative quote was, we would have a lot of different things to measure outcomes from ourselves and our patients and hope they're doing, but I don't think there's anyone currently that really encompasses all we need. If something could be devised that would involve all of us without giving people a giant stack of papers or electronic forms to fill out every single time they see us, that would be incredibly helpful, and hopefully we will get there. And I think that's something that resonates with all doctors, regardless of whether they're taking care of facial paralysis or any other patient, working with trying to devise an outcome model that is simple but satisfactory is key. And so, you know, looking at the data from these two studies, or from this study in particular, we found that the qualitative study suggests that acoustic neuroma patients with facial paralysis really did lack adequate counseling, or they felt they did, in preparation for life with facial paralysis. And after injury to the nerve, providers who treat them should consider the patient's goals, preferences, and values to ensure that appropriate treatment decisions are made. Now, the reconstructive surgeons did seem to be following a systematic algorithm to assess the physical symptoms. However, we did find that there was not a clear and simple systematic algorithm for following the emotional aspects. As I mentioned, only 5 patients asked about emotional health. 6 patients offered, or 6 doctors offered referrals for emotional health or for psychological issues. Only 7 of the 10 offered or asked questionnaires or provided questionnaires and depression, anxiety indices or scores on patients. And so while all 10 of them were looking at the physical symptoms, there's still some missing who do not focus on the emotional side effects. And so why is this data important? Well, you know, our future directions are really, now that we've assessed a cohort of patients with acoustic neuroma who developed facial paralysis and the treating physicians, we really want to assess provider perceptions on the preparation of patients. So we have to go back one step. And we will be polling and providing surveys for the lateral skull-based community, as well as neurotologists, to really find out how prepared they feel they are preparing patients for surgery and for the side effect of facial paralysis. The goal of that is to really find out if the patients themselves who developed the facial paralysis, who we spoke with, were biased, and to see if there's anything more that can be done to help better or to help improve the education for these patients who really are suffering based on the data that I presented you. We also want to perform a larger survey of facial plastic surgeons to assess the management of physical and emotional aspects. Once we have this information, we want to identify the gaps between the patients and providers. And the goal really is to develop a new educational model to help bridge the gaps. We really want to make sure that every patient who has a vestibular schwannoma or acoustic neuroma that develops facial paralysis then knows what to do, where to seek care, and knows what their options are, rather than having, as one patient mentioned, having to go out on their own and develop a treatment plan for themselves. And so, you know, one of the things that we found from our work looking at facial plastic surgeons was that the tools available to assess outcomes were not ideal. And so we'll switch gears slightly now, talking about how can we improve tools to assess outcomes. And so specifically looking at how do we dynamically treat facial paralysis and what tools are available to assess those outcomes. And so I touched upon earlier the functional deficits related to facial paralysis and the psychological deficits. And so what do we as surgeons offer patients when they come into our clinics? Well, there's a wide variety of options. And the options for reanimation really do factor on the duration of the paralysis, the extent of the paralysis, which facial third is involved, upper, middle, lower face, and also which comorbidities are other comorbidities. For instance, I'm often asked if we do these surgeries on patients who have strokes. Well, yes and no. I do find that patients who've had cerebrovascular accidents actually will recover a fair amount of facial movement. But some of these surgeries involve using masseter nerve or using hypoglossal nerve to re-innervate portions of the face. And if a patient's already suffering from severe dysarthria, I don't want to do anything that's going to make it worse. And or they're having aspiration or other issues related to swallowing, we have to be very careful about what we offer the patient. And so today for this talk, I'll focus mostly on the dynamic procedures that we do, which are nerve grafts, nerve transfers, regional muscle transfers, and free tissue transfer. And so an example of a regional muscle transfer is something called a temporalis tendon transfer. This is a woman who was 1 year post-acoustic neuroma surgery. She unfortunately developed a complete paralysis on the left side. And this is her 4-month post-operative. And actually she looked even better 4 weeks post-operative. In this case, we dissect an incision through the cheek. We can find our way to the coronoid process of the mandible. We cut that using a saw, and we bring the tendon that's in the temporalis region right in front of the ear. We tunnel it under the cheek, and we attach it to the corner of the mouth. And so when they bite down, these patients are able to generate a smile. For patients who are eligible, we can offer nerve transfers, as we did in this patient. And so this gentleman had a radical parotidectomy in which his facial nerve was resected. At the same time of his surgery, I performed a masseter nerve to facial nerve transfer, in which we attached it to a branch that was innervating the buccal, the zygomatic and buccal branches. And so you can see him at 12 months post-op as well. Now, neither one of these patients is able to show teeth when they smile. And that's, I would say that's the, that's not the exception. That's the rule for masseter nerve transfer and temporalis tendon transfer, is that it is very difficult for patients to make what we call a Duchenne smile, where they're showing their teeth. And so that's an area that we are trying to improve. This is a young girl who had congenital facial paralysis of her mid and upper face. She did have her marginal nerve intact, which is why her smile looks somewhat symmetric. And we did a gracilis-free tissue transfer, where we transferred tissue from her right thigh into the left face, and we attached it to a nerve that was crossing the face, attached to her functional facial nerve on the right side. And we also used her masseter nerve to innervate. So we did dual innervation on this free tissue transfer gracilis flap. And you can see here, she has slightly more elevation of the upper or middle face. Now, this is a young girl who had acoustic neuroma, and she was actually seen by a neurosurgeon and sent to us. She was operated on in the community, and her neurosurgeon, original neurosurgeon, did tell her that there was nothing they could do to help her. And she was one of the interviewees in the study I showed you earlier. Luckily for her, she saw one of the neurosurgeons, Dr. Tiffany Avila, who's no longer here in Holy Cross, and then was transferred to our care. And so she had an excellent outcome. We did a masseter nerve and a hypoglossal nerve transfer on her right side. And this is her 3 years post-op, and we still see her, and she looks better and better all the time. And in this case, you can see that she did develop a nice a dental show on the right side. Likewise, this is another gentleman with an excellent outcome. He actually underwent a slightly different course. He had a basal cell carcinoma that was invading the mastoid behind his ear, and it invaded the facial nerve. And so in order to cover such a large defect, we did a free tissue transfer, taking tissue from his thigh. We also were able to use the nerve to vastus to interpose between the proximal and distal branches of the facial nerve, and also use the nerve to masseter transfer. And you can see here, the first image is 3 months after the surgery. It usually takes about 4 to 6 months for the nerve to reinnervate. And then at 12 months, you can see he has a fantastic smile. And so, you know, I've shown you static images of these patients, and in all of them, they look great, but the world is dynamic. And so our area that we wanted to really improve was how to improve measurements on these dynamic images of patients, or videos of patients, so that we can then hopefully come up with better solutions. Because while the solutions we have look great in still photos, they don't always look great in dynamic. And I'll show you here, this is a patient here. And so I'll turn the sound off, but you can see here when she's speaking, you know, she's still really talking out of the left side of her mouth. Now this is at 4 months, and her nerves and everything are still getting better. But you can see, I'll ask her to smile in a moment, and you'll see that she can give a nice smile, but when she's doing most of her talking, it's still very distracting for the observer. And so she'll give a smile in just a moment. You can see her raising her eyebrows, closing her eyes, wrinkling her nose, and now smiling. And so while she does have some symmetry there, and there it looks even better, when she's speaking, it's not really the same. And so now let's look at her. This is 2 years later. And so you can see she has much better control over her speech and when she's talking. But at the same time, there's still more of the left side moving. And how do you account for that? How do you grade that? How can you say whether somebody has a good outcome, an excellent outcome, or a poor outcome when you're only looking at still images. I'll skip over this one. So, but what you can see here is a comparison between, you know, the before and after static images, which you might see on Instagram or, you know, social media or somebody's website, and what you see in the cutouts from the video frame or from the, you know, frames from their dynamic movement. They're, you know, the question is, are they really the same outcome? And why is it difficult to report these outcomes in facial paralysis? Well, we have low volumes of patients. Providers don't really share data. There's considerable subjectivity amongst our grading systems, as some of you may know. There's a lack of reliability between observers who may be considered experts. The long-term applicability of our grading systems is unknown, and there are significant differences between still and video reporting, as I just mentioned. And so what is the ideal tool for assessing facial paralysis? Well, luckily, the Sir Charles Bell Society, which is an international society of facial nerve experts, including neurosurgeons, otolaryngologists, facial plastic surgeons, and neurotologists, and other plastic surgeons, came up with the criteria. And so they wanted this tool to be easy for our convenient for clinical use. It needs to include regional scoring for the entire face. It should include both static and dynamic measures. It should include features to measure secondary sequelae such as synkinesis. It must be reproducible with low inter and intra observer variability, and it should be sensitive to changes over time or following interventions. And the ideal tool, according to the Sir Charles Bell Society, which was published in PRS in 2015, will be objective, allow for easy communication between practitioners, and should include information about emotional health. Now, in 2015, they looked at a review looked at 19 different grading scales, and none were actually widely accepted as superior. Only one, the Sunnybrook grading scale, was satisfied all the criteria I mentioned. Now, the conclusion of this paper was that all scales are subjective to limitations because of varying degrees of subjectivity, reliability, or longitudinal applicability. And they said that a quantitative technology-based system was not widely available, it was too expensive, and clinicians were forced to rely on some form of subjective methodology. Well, that was 2015, and now it's 2022, and a lot can change. And so artificial intelligence and machine learning have really taken over. Now, not all is good, but just to give you a simple idea of what the system is, we take an ordinary system, such as a Sunnybrook grading system, we overlay artificial intelligence and machine learning, and now we can create a tool that can learn, predict, and improve on its own without the need for retraining or having subjectivity. There's many examples of machine learning in medicine. Pathologists use it for help with diagnosis, as do radiologists. Diagnostic lab testing and drug development have been using artificial intelligence and machine learning. Many of our hospital systems, including Providence, are studying patient experience and patient flow optimization using artificial intelligence and machine learning. Patient safety has made incredible strides. And there's also virtual reality-based surgical procedures that can be performed using these tools. And so the question for us was, could machine learning be applied to the evaluation of kinetic movement? And the answer is yes. And so this is an example of a tool using a open source program that our collaborators at USC in this Viterbi School of Engineering were able to adapt for the purposes that we needed. And you can see here, this is a normal face. And these dots, for lack of a better word, or can define different aspects of the face, the brow, the eye, the mouth, the nose, and they move with the patient, and they move with this specimen, and the jitter and the movement can be measured. And here you can see it on a person with paralysis. And so you can see that this tool is able to be used not just in the normal patient, but can also be used in a patient who has paralysis. Let's see here to show. And so this study, our hypothesis was that there would be no significant difference in the quantification of facial asymmetry using between a landmarks-based system and between clinical experts, myself and two of my colleagues who were performing standardized and validated EFACE scores. And I didn't go into it, but the EFACE is a scoring system that uses static images to assess patients. And so we were using that as our benchmark, and we were comparing the program to that. And this is just a background on how the frame extraction was performed from the videos that we took of patients, how they were processed, and how each frame had landmark processing placed over it, and then showing that the overlaid landmarks were then extracted. Again, using machine learning tools. And so these are the different measurements we looked at. The first study, this landmark, LFAM is the landmark facial asymmetry measures. And so we looked at brow, we looked at medial lateral brow, we looked at oral commissure or the corners of the mouth. We looked at facial symmetry angles, and we looked at eye opening ratio, or how much one eye opened compared to the other. And so, you know, in order to do this, we had patients perform specific tasks. And so these tasks were then broken up into segments, looking at eyebrow elevation, gentle and tight eye closure, wrinkling your nose, making a gentle Mona Lisa smile, a large smile, pursing of the lips. And we also asked them to converse in 1 to 2 sentences to see if we could assess spontaneous movement. And so this is an example here of our tool in place. And so
the first thing you're going to do is ask people to beep and say your name.
You can hear a beep. And so they were prompted after these sounds to perform different maneuvers. You can see some spontaneous movement there.
What was the cause?
So you'll see here, they hold a pose from one sound to the next, and we're able to assess that using the program. And so we have published our first paper on that, and we found that the landmark-based system was able to match up closely with our E-face scoring system, especially for the brow and for smile movements and measurements. I'm sorry I didn't include that data here. I thought I had, but it must have been a different presentation. And so we are currently expanding on this program using actually a new software called Face Mesh that is open source from Google. And the goal is to be able to not only assess outcomes on patients who've had complete paralysis to surgery, but also to look at more closely synkinesis and see how synkinesis can improve before and after treatments using Botox, using physical therapy, or potentially surgery as well. And so the advantage of using the facial landmarks was that it's ease of extraction and quick reconfigurations. It provides a promising direction for automated analysis without the need for subjective measurements, stacks of papers, and lots of unnecessary data. And it can really be further expanded to include more fine-grained aspects of facial asymmetry, as I mentioned just now, looking at synkinesis before and after surgery, and also for patients who have other aspects of facial paralysis. And so again, why is it clinically relevant? Well, we want to use this program to not only assess patients that have been treated, but maybe for patients who are just undergoing recovery, patients who have Bell's palsy, Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, patients who have paralysis after surgery, and to give them data to support that maybe now is not the time to intervene and do a surgery, but they may be progressing slowly but surely, and we can capture that data and show it to them. And it's very objective instead of being subjective. We may be able to refine the evaluation of our reanimation outcomes. As I mentioned, many of our surgeries only provide patients with a Mona Lisa smile or no teeth. Being able to see, is that really something that's making an improvement in the patient's life? And also be able to see if there's certain procedures that can cause higher rates of oral commissure excursion. Maybe we need to change what we do. And again, an assistance in surgical decision-making, as I mentioned. The improvements that we are trying to make is we're really trying to incorporate spontaneous movement for evaluation. That to date is something that is kind of uncharted territory for anyone studying patients with facial paralysis. It would be akin to somebody who's doing cochlear implant work, looking specifically at if patients can discern different pitches of music and to see different aspects of things that we may take for granted with our quality of life. And so while, again, as I mentioned, we've got a great static images of patients with facial paralysis, our next step is to really make dynamic movement better. And I think technology like this can help lead the way. We want to create a mobile-based platform to use this so that physicians can see patients and not necessarily have to have them come in the office to do these videos, that they can be shared between, also shared between providers so that we can pull the data and assess it more formally. And then we want to figure out a way to incorporate quality of life measures. As I mentioned early on in my talk, that's really what has kind of driven me to become passionate about, or what I am really passionate about, improving the quality of life of my patients. I'm pretty confident I can make a patient smile that comes to me with facial paralysis, but I don't know if I can ever make them feel whole again. And I think that's something we should all strive to do because there's too many patients who look good but don't feel good. And I think that we can do a lot more to change that. And so I do want to acknowledge my collaborators from the USC School of Engineering, Digbele Bose, who's a PhD candidate, Dr. Krishna Samandapelli, who's actually completed his PhD, and Dr. Srikant Narayanan, who is the head of the lab, Dr. Taiman Tai, who's a recent graduate of the otolaryngology department at USC, and Dr. Courtney Volker, who is also our collaborator at PNI now. She was at USC with me when we started this project. And so I'll leave you with this quote. There is no knowing for a fact. The only dependable things are humility and looking. And so I think 5 or 10 years ago, if I had shown myself some of the photos of the patients that we could do, I would have been amazed. And I would have said, you know, why look even farther? But after seeing these patients and experiencing life with them, I think that there is a lot more we can do. And if anything, I hope today for those of you who see patients in the office with facial paralysis, you know, don't overlook them if they are able to smile or look somewhat symmetric at rest. There is always something else that we can do to help them, and we're happy to help you with that if you have any questions.
Thank you, Amit. That was wonderful as always, and it was a very nice progression from your talk a couple of years ago. My hope is, you know, you'll come back in a few months and sort of give the update, because it sounds like it's every couple of years, there's like a whole new element of things that we can do here. So I think that's very exciting. One of the things I'd like you to comment on here is you mentioned it early in the talk. When you have a complex acoustic neuroma, for example, and surgery with patients with, you know, balance problems, hearing loss, facial weakness after surgery, and especially now, the coordination of care for these patients is, you know, downright overwhelming, and it's only gotten harder with the lack of resources related to COVID and everything. Can you speak a little bit to that and the coordination, and perhaps not necessarily a plug, but the importance of these multidisciplinary approaches?
No, I think you're exactly right. You know, it really does depend on what expertise is available. And so ideally before surgery, when a patient, you know, is referred to you and you refer them to Dr. Volker or to one of your colleagues to coordinate, ideally someone like myself would be a part of that preoperative consultation, even if it's just for a few minutes, to say to a patient, hey, look, you know, likelihood of you having any injury to the facial nerve is low, but if you do, Dr. Kochhar is here, or a member of our team is here. And that's how a lot of, you know, some of the more, like I would say, tertiary care centers have done it. At Hopkins, that was how we did it. But it was also, everybody saw patients in the clinic in the same place. I will say now, though, with COVID and having the opportunity to do virtual appointments, it's pretty straightforward. You know, if for me, you know, seeing a patient is not as, I don't need to necessarily touch them or look at them as much as you guys might from a surgical perspective, but just to meet them and go through some of the treatment options if they were to encounter that. It's fairly easy now with our virtual platforms. From a hearing and balance standpoint, you know, I'll have to defer to Dr. Volker, but I do think we are getting better at that. We found more resources in the community down in Orange County, especially from our therapists that we work with. We now have a speech and language pathologist that works out of the Santa Monica office, and I believe they're trying to expand that program in the next few years. And so ultimately, you know, yes, we would have a once a month, maybe a multidisciplinary clinic for these patients specifically, where they see you, Dr. Volker, Dr. Barkadarian for follow-up for their tumor. If they have facial paralysis related issues, they would see me, maybe the speech therapist in the afternoon. And then we would do a roundtable discussion. We're working towards that. And you're right, maybe in 2 years, that will be the talk I give. I'd be really happy if that was a talk that I was giving.
Mm-hmm. It's definitely needed work in progress here. Let me pull up a couple of these questions here. And for those who put questions in the chat box, if you can transfer them to the Q&A, we'll make sure we didn't miss them. So from Dr. Walensky, do you use, I think this is a surgical question, do you use multimodality intraoperative neurophysiologic monitoring with ABRs, BEARS, facial EMG, and nerve proximity mapping, SSEPs and MEPs in your acoustic neuroma resection surgeries? The short answer is yes, we use all of those modalities, and they tend to be quite helpful. Not 100%, but they tend to make the surgery a lot safer than it used to be. Dr. Briganti always asks great questions. He asks, has anything changed in the management of Bell's palsy? Well, let's go question by question because they're somewhat different.
So interestingly enough, there is at least one clinical trial I know. I believe it's on Ramsey Hunt and not Bell's, but I think it would be adapted to Bell's palsy in the future where they're looking at IVIG. And so at UCLA, there's a clinical trial being run by Dr. Ishiyama from neurology and co-run by Dr. Ishiyama, her husband, Dr. Ishiyama from head and neck surgery. And they've started giving patients IVIG immediately. And they've found some very, very good results. I don't know anything more than just what I've, you know, anecdotally, what I've been told and what's been briefly presented. I don't know the rationale. I believe it's, you know, IVIG has autoimmune properties or anti-autoimmune properties. And they believe that may be helping, but that's the only thing I know that's, you know, potentially a new game changer for patients with that. Now, it's not a resource that's available to everyone. Most of these patients present to urgent care or to their primary doctor. So an IVIG is not cheap, and I do believe it requires a hospitalization, but that is something that is on the horizon. So I think if you have a patient with Ramsey Hunt, you may want to inquire to see if there's a center or a near you that's offering that. From any COVID or COVID vaccine related facial issues, you know, I have not seen anything that I can say is related to COVID. I've had a couple of patients tell me that soon after the vaccination, they developed Bell's palsy. I think a lot of doctors are seeing that around the country. You know, what I've been told by members of our community is that the numbers of Bell's palsy are not out of proportion to what they would normally be any given year. And based on the initial vaccine trials that were done back in 2020, the number of patients that developed Bell's palsy, the percentage out of the number that were vaccinated was the same number that would normally get them anyway. So there's no relationship. Now, I have also talked to other doctors who think that there are pain and nerve inflammation issues related to the COVID vaccine. I'm not an expert on that, so I can't say it, but I have not seen it in my practice. And any facial issues seen as a result of dental procedures? I have not seen any facial paralysis. I've seen patients come into my office with severe facial pain, you know, where they may think that it's triggering a trigeminal neuralgia, but that's something I would defer to Dr. Sivakumar, Dr. Barkadarian. It's not really my area of expertise.
Yeah, you can, I would agree with what Dr. Kochhar said. So Dr. Campen asks, at what point do you consider surgical repair, I'm assuming of the facial nerve, when a patient has non-cancer or surgical cause of paralysis, like autoimmune or other CNS pathology?
Well, typically if a patient hasn't recovered within 6 months, and when I say hasn't recovered, I mean no functional recovery, as in they're still considered a Hausbrockmann 6 with complete flaccid paralysis, and I've ruled out all other causes. We've done MRIs, we've done CT scans, and there's no other cause that we can think of. We would start the conversation knowing that we have until about 12 to 18 months. Sooner is obviously always better, but I would say no earlier than 6 months. And so that, I mean, it's and then when it says a non or a surgical cause of paralysis like autoimmune, so I haven't seen too many autoimmune causes of paralysis. CNS pathology, everyone's different. It really depends. You know, if it's an acoustic neuroma patient and the nerve has been cut, then I know we're going to intervene as soon as possible whenever the patient's available. When it's a patient who has an acoustic neuroma benign tumor and the nerve hasn't been cut, but they still have paralysis, we'll usually wait at least 6 months and we'll reassess. And again, I think that's why the artificial intelligence tool will be so helpful, because it really will provide objective data as opposed to someone's subjective opinion on how much recovery there has been over the course of 6 months, because we'll be able to compare the immediate visit with 6 months later. But usually 6 months is my kind of when I start letting the patient know we want to intervene. We have until 12 to 18, but the data suggests better results occur with earlier intervention.
Are you doing facial nerve EMG in the clinic or sending them out for it?
No, I've never found it to be too useful. It's mostly based on clinical examination.
Okay. And then Dr. Tam asks, what are potential pitfalls of using machine learning and evaluating facial paralysis? Any concerns about accuracy of these computer programs? And he says, remember heart. I'm not exactly sure what that last part
means. That is. You know, I have a whole nother talk on the pitfalls of machine learning and artificial intelligence related to ethical considerations. I have not spent a lot of time studying the accuracy, but now that you mention it, I will. But there are some significant ethical considerations that anybody working with artificial intelligence and machine learning must take into account. There have been countless studies showing that this type of information and research can be used in an unethical way. For instance, there have been times when nations have used it to target certain populations for genocide, with the Hmong population in Asia and China. And there have been, issues with police using it to find perpetrators of crimes and then finding out later. So yes, so accuracy is very important when trying to isolate certain individuals. When it comes to the accuracy of facial movement, there's always a physician evaluating the data as well. And so an expert, I would say. So in that setting, yes, we do want to assess the accuracy and make sure it is. But I also think that if there wasn't an accurate assessment, we would be able to visualize it. We're not so much worried about the patients that are, we're more or less trying to use this data in addition to help us support the argument to offer surgery patients in some cases, not so much to talk patients out of surgery, I guess would be the way I would answer that.
That's great. That was very helpful. I'll give it a couple of seconds here to see if there's any other last minute questions. But just a reminder, the Providence Little Company of Mary Medical Staff Picnic is going to be in 2 weeks. It's at a local nearby park. You will need to RSVP for it. So please reach out if you guys haven't received that invitation. It's sure to be a good time. And one last question from Dr. Marvey. For Bell's palsy, what is the time window for treatment with steroids and antivirals?
That's a great question. So sooner the better. I will say that, I sometimes see patients, not too often, but sometimes patients will come in a month later without any recovery and they've already received one round of steroids. I don't believe there's any harm in offering a second, maybe even a third round, but I usually space it out about a month apart. But the first, within the first 72 hours, obviously antivirals to prevent postherpetic neuralgia and then high dose steroids. And when I say high dose steroids, we're not talking about a Medrol dose pack. We're talking about 60 milligrams of prednisone and tapering it down over the course of 10 to 12 days. And I do tell patients that they're going to have the significant side effects that comes with that dose, but that's what the white papers say to provide patients. And the delayed recovery, 1 month, 6 weeks, I will usually give a second round.
Thank you, Dr. Kochhar. I know you have to get to meetings here at 1:30. We very much appreciate your time. That was fantastic. And we should probably set that next follow-up talk up as this stuff advances. Thank you everyone for joining. As always, we will be back in October next Tuesday with Dr. Philip Towski from Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital in Boston, talking about a neurovascular topic. More to come on that. And as always, if there's any preferences or requests that you guys have, please reach out. Thank you guys and have a safe and healthy month.
Thank you very much.
Take care, everyone.